you know.
Welcome back to Open Line. We have the Crackpot Gardener with us. So just taking your gardening questions as we head into the fall, you brought this very great collection here of herbs that you grew in your garden. And I've learned a great deal about that already, and they smell great, as I've said. But for people who are interested, you have a Facebook page as well, right? Where you talk about all this stuff.
I do. I kind of go over all this stuff, and it's the, you have to look it up. It's called The Crackpot Gardener, and then there I'll address things. People can ask me questions. They can also go to my, I get a lot of questions, and, you know, I love that. So ask me questions. If, you know, if you don't have time to call in, you can always address it there. And, yeah, that's what
the
we do.
The Crackpot Gardener. Crackpot Gardener. Okay, that's important.
Yes. If you knew me well, you'd say that. Most people understand that right off.
All right, and I like this. I mean, I like going through this because it's interesting to me that nature provides what is needed in many cases to, we spend a lot of money on insecticides, herbicides, all that, but you're saying they're natural.
They're natural, yes.
You know, we don't need to maybe dump all that stuff on there because if we grew a certain plant beside another plant, it would keep bugs away, which I think is very interesting.
Yes.
But what, all right, so what else do we have in there?
Well, we have another herb that a lot of plants have insecticidal properties. Another one would be tansy. Now, tansy, you have to kind of use a, you know, a little caution with it because it, you know, it is rogue in some states and people just go, oh, I can't believe you're talking about tansy, because it can become invasive if you allow it to.
Like kudzu.
Not quite that. Not quite that bad, no.
Okay, good.
But it does, especially some of the western states, I've seen that it does grow everywhere. But I like to grow this on the edge of my garden because of the insect, you know, properties, I mean, how it keeps insects away. And a lot of times in gardening, I have found that, you know, insects are coming in and they kind of use their sense of smell to get to their food. And a lot of times they're coming in and I explain it that, you know, they're coming in and they're honing in on that plant. They're just, you know, they're coming in for that cauliflower. They're coming in for that broccoli. And then all of a sudden they get this strong whiff of something and it throws them off and they get all discombobulated. You can look that one up. and they get confused. And then it gives our good insects, our beneficial insects, time to come and take care of them. So, so they all work together. But this plant I especially like. I've started growing this one again because I love it for the fact that it helps keep squash bugs away. Squash bugs are like one of my worst things in the garden, and because I like to do everything organically, you can hand pick them off for a long time, but I try to find things that they don't like, and one thing they don't like is tansy. So I will grow tansy and I will cut it and I will just lay it between my plants, and that will help. It's very odorous, strong, and that helps to keep them away. So, you know, there's lots of times you have to do many different things. I also hand pick them. I take the eggs when I see the eggs on the leaves and I, you know, rub them off, kill the baby's eggs. We don't want any more. And you cannot be squeamish and be a gardener, just so you know. You got to be tough. And so, but this is a plant that you can use for that. You can also bring this inside for moths and for, you know, bugs that maybe come inside the house and eat your wool, favorite wool coat or things like that. You can actually turn these into, you know, dry them and put them in sachets, combinations of things, maybe with lavender and artemisia and things, cedar, and make a, you know, kind of a nice little sweet smelling sachet that bugs don't like and throw it in your drawers and such, you know.
So how did you get into this? I mean, did this happen early in life, you know, middle life, or when did you become so knowledgeable and just this passion arise?
Well, I've always loved plants, and I, you know, that's, I went to school in horticulture and I grew up on a farm. But I think when I really got into herbs is when I was working at a nuclear power plant. And one of the ladies there said, hey, why don't you grow herbs and stay home? Because she knew that I, you know, would much rather be home with my family then. And she said, you know, you could do this on the, you could do this as a business. She goes, I did it for years when my kids were growing up. And she goes, it's time. She goes, you should do that. So she hands me a jar of parsley seed, which is hilarious because parsley seed is one of the hardest seeds to start.
Oh, no.
They say it goes to the devil 13 times and back, you know. and it's very difficult. But so she hands me parsley seeds and says, you know, you ought to stay home and try growing herbs. And I thought, I love plants. I could do that. So I started growing herbs, and we lived on 20 acres at the time, and I had my brother come over and plow up you know, quarter acre or something, and I just planted rows and rows and rows of herbs. I didn't know what to do with them or what they were, but I planted them, and then I harvested them, and then I had lots of them, and then I started using them and learning about them, and, you know, it's just been a journey.
So you worked at a nuclear power plant? Is that what you said?
Yes, I did.
So that would be,
on the maintenance crew.
I feel like almost the opposite of herb gardening.
Well, when you live in northern Michigan in a little harbor town, there, you know, I looked at where the best paying jobs were, mm-hmm. and that mm-hmm. was one of the best. And so, you know, nobody really knew what was, you know, we didn't know microwaves might be dangerous. We didn't know, you know, nuclear power plants could be, you know, dangerous. They're clean power,
right.
And there's precautions, and you glow, but you could over that.
You glow. It helps you when you garden at
yeah,
night.
Yeah, it's all good.
So how long before you felt comfortable?
Well,
how long did it take?
It doesn't take that long to start. Well, it took years, but, you know, if you use them all the time and you get used to using them and they just become second nature. We moved to Tennessee and I started growing them and we started a greenhouse and I was homeschooling my children. So we just started Coyote Herb Ranch and we started selling plants and teaching classes and just basically teaching what I knew. And I did a lot of studying. I study all the time. So.
Would you say it's easier to grow in Michigan or in Tennessee, or are they the same?
Both are fabulous places, you know, just different plants. We have humidity here, we have really cold there. So, you know, French tarragon, very difficult to grow here, grows like a weed there. But we can grow things here that are more difficult to grow there. So it's a toss-up.
Mm-hmm.
It's all good. If there's, you know, and what I have found, a lot of plants have similar properties. So, for instance, French tarragon is very difficult to grow here because it doesn't like our humidity. But we all love to use French tarragon, you know, with chicken and different things. And so, but I found Mexican marigold has that same flavor. And it loves the cold. It loves the humidity and the cold here, so it does beautifully. So I just substitute things. You learn.
All right, now we're coming up on, I was going to say Thanksgiving. We're coming up on Halloween,
uh-huh.
pumpkins, and
uh-huh.
and there's a question, using gourds, pumpkins, and winter squash for decorations. We have only a few minutes left. What should people know about that?
Well, there's lots of natural things to use for decorations, and I love that. I love this time of year because you can go outside, you can go to the garden, and you can collect, you know, I grow all kinds of great squashes and gourds and, you know, all these pumpkins, and then they're just so simple to fill a basket, and you've got this beautiful display, and then you can still eat them, not the gourds, but the pumpkins and things, you can still eat them later, so you can just kind of use them until you need to. But there's all kinds of, you know, nuts and flower heads that dry. And if you just look around your garden, you'll see all kinds of things that you can put together real simply and have a beautiful fall display. So that's just one more way of using the things that you grow in your garden or maybe your neighbors.
You know. In our final 30 seconds, is there one other thing there?
Sweet Annie. If you're a crafter and you love to make wreaths, Sweet Annie grows. You'll see it in
Sweet
pastures,
Annie.
Along the sides of the roads. It has this really incredible smell. They call it the Chinese Christmas tree, but it makes beautiful, beautiful wreaths. And you can make wreaths and they'll be beautiful all winter and they help to keep the insects out. And so this is something that is just for those who love to make things or dried arrangements. This is a beautiful plant to use for that. And also, you know, when you bring it inside, it keeps insects out. So.
Excellent. Okay, we're going to take a break. Come back, wrap everything up. Be back right after this.